My name is Donald Lewis, professor of entomology at Iowa State University, and it's my pleasure to spend some time with you today to talk about insecticide mode of action, the IRAC codes, and insecticide resistance. The insecticide mode of action will be important to you as you prepare to spray insecticides and miticides in your orchard, vineyard, or fruit production area in the coming year. The insecticide mode of action refers to how an insecticide works. You are applying molecules of insecticide in your spray solution, and when those molecules are inside the insect, what happens? How do those molecules of chemical disrupt the physiology and the function of the insect? We refer to these different mode of actions as chemical classes, and we know there's about 57 different known ways that insecticides will work at the control of an insect. There are a dozen more that are not known, but we have lots of tools in the toolbox when we reach for an insecticide to control a pest problem. The insecticide mode of action that you're probably most familiar with are neurotoxins or nerve toxins. These are chemicals that affect the nervous system of the insect. And the nervous system does for the insect what it does for you. It senses the external environment. It communicates among the tissues. It coordinates voluntary movements such as running, flying, mating, and so forth. And it coordinates involuntary movements such as the beating of the heart. Most of the insecticides that you have used in the past are nerve poisons. That is, their mode of action is, in some way, they affect the nervous system of the insect. And here you can see the list of insecticides that you're familiar with. Many of the older insecticides were these nerve poisons, but some of our new ones, like the pyrethroids, the neonicotinoids, and the phenylpyrazoles, are also nerve poisons. But calling them nerve poisons is an oversimplification because they're not all the same. They do not all have the same mode of action. There are at least 14 different ways that our insecticides affect the nervous system of our pest insects and mites. The nervous system is quite complex. There are lots of little moving parts of the nervous system, and that leaves many sites of activity where a nerve poison can work. So nerve poisons are not all the same, and we'll look at that in just a little bit. In addition to the nerve poisons, there are also physical poisons like soaps and oils and diatomaceous earth, which control insects either by suffocation or abrasion. We also have insecticides that disrupt the cell, the action of the cell or the cell membrane, and that would be our soaps and oils again. We also have metabolic chemicals that disrupt things like energy transfer. They could shut down cellular functions. And this would be some of the familiar insecticides that we are using currently, and some of the older ones like rotenone. There's a fifth class of chemicals, and those are the ones that we call the insect growth regulators. These are chemicals that, when applied to an insect, interrupt or disrupt the normal growth and function of the body. Mostly these mimic hormones that the insects already have, which makes them non-toxic to mammals. But in order to successfully use an insect growth regulator, you have to critically time the application so that it goes on to the immature stage. Adult insects don't grow. So you have to have these insect growth regulators on the immature stage. And a couple of those that you're familiar with are the azadiractin, sold under the trade names Neem and Neem X, and the insecticide difluobenzuron. Well, when we talk about this mode of action or chemical classes, there are at least 30 different chemical classes that are identified by the Insecticide Resistance Action Committee. We just call that IRAC for short. It has nothing to do with a country that sounds about the same the way it's pronounced, but Insecticide Resistance Action Committee is a huge global network that studies how insecticides work and then classifies them into a system that we can understand. Those IRAC codes are listed in the Midwest Fruit Pest Management Guide, and that's where you get this information. You can often get this information from the insecticide label or from the manufacturer or from the chemical dealer. But a few years ago, we started putting the IRAC codes into the Midwest Fruit Pest Management Guide because that IRAC code unlocks the information that you need to practice insecticide resistance management. Well, it's a huge group of insecticides that are in our spray guide, and you can see the different classes of insecticides that are in the spray guide. 18 different classes are included in the list that we have in the spray guide, and 21 different subclasses. So there's a lot to choose from. There's a lot to think about, and that's what we'll spend the rest of the time talking about. IRAC is a international group. It's a coordinated industry response, and it was specifically started to keep insecticides working and to avoid insecticide resistance. And that process is called resistance management. You can find all this information online, irac-online.org. The latest revision came out in March of 2020, so we're about due for another revision. So make sure you get the latest information. Well, in order to talk about resistance management, we have to talk about resistance. And insecticide resistance is an inherited change within the insect body. So an insect has inherited something from its parents that allows it to withstand or be immune or be resistant to the labeled amount of insecticide that you're applying. So those insects that have that inherited characteristic are no longer killed by the insecticide. That means they are able to reproduce, and they pass on their resistant genes to their offspring, the next generation. So by repeatedly applying that insecticide, you are selecting and killing the weakest individuals in the population, leaving the resistant individuals to multiply and dominate the population. Well, if we put that in a little graphic, this is what it looks like in the upper left-hand corner. Before application, the first generation has a lot of susceptible insects shown in white, and it has that resistant insect, which already had that resistance before the insecticide was applied. Then you apply the insecticide and you kill almost all of the susceptible insects, but the resistant insect is left to reproduce. And in the next generation, there are more resistant insects. You spray them again, you kill off the weak susceptible ones. You keep doing that over and over, and you end up with a population that is resistant. So the population has evolved resistance because of the selection you were applying. Well, resistance doesn't happen every time you use an insecticide. It happens with some pests more often than others. And a lot of it has to do with what rate of reproduction that pest has. So when things like aphids and mites that have several generations per year are more likely to develop resistance than white grubs that only have one generation per year or one generation every 3 years. Is there migration of those insects into your orchard or vineyard or fruit planting? Japanese beetles don't stay put. They would be migrating into your vineyard from outside, and so you're always diluting the gene pool with immigration from outside. The rate, timing, and number of applications that you make will also influence resistance, and it becomes a fairly complicated process to determine how resistance happens, when it's going to happen, and will it happen to you? Well, after sufficient selection pressure, after a sufficient number of applications of insecticide, the resistant insects outnumber the susceptible ones, and the spray that you used to use with great success no longer works at all. Some codling moth populations here in the upper Midwest have suspected or confirmed insecticide resistance. That's not a good thing. We have resistant mites in some of our orchards as well. One of the personal pests that has shown a lot of insecticide resistance is head lice. Not a fruit pest, but if you ever have children in a grade school and they've had a head lice problem, you knew how difficult it was to control those head lice because of insecticide resistance. That same control difficulty will happen in your orchard or vineyard if insecticide resistance happens. So insecticide resistance management is an effort to prevent that evolution of resistance in the pest population, or at least contain it, and if not prevent it, at least delay it. What that does is keep effective insecticides working for you. As long as those insects are not resistant to that insecticide, it's a good choice for you to use. And the reason we stress prevention of insecticide resistance is because it's easier to prevent resistance than it will be to reverse it after it has already happened. Well, how do we practice insecticide resistance? First off, you practice IPM. You use cultural controls, you use biological controls, you do all the non-chemical things you can to control the pest populations and to prevent damage. Then you follow very closely the proper timing to target the most vulnerable life stage. Do not apply insecticides when they are not appropriate for the pest you're trying to control. Make very careful applications as far as when the insect is present. Mix and apply carefully, and especially we need to use the full label rate. What is the dose? What is the coverage? These are things that if you do properly, it will delay the onset of insecticide resistance. Finally, the other thing we do is use insecticide rotations, alternations, or sweet sequences of different insecticide classes. Emphasis, not different insecticides, different insecticide classes. And we base those rotations on resistant management on the mode of action of the number of the insecticide. Remember, there were insecticides that had a letter after them? That doesn't matter. We look at the number. So to look at miticides that are currently available for control of apple mites in the orchard, you'll see acromite is a 20D IRAC code. Canamite, circled in red, is a 20B. The B and D won't matter for resistance management. You must use just the number. Go to an insecticide the next time that has a number, IRAC number, different than the D. And Envidor is IRAC code 23, and so is Movento. So if you've used Movento one time, you don't go to the different insecticide and Envidor the next time because they are in the same IRAC code. So rotating by mode of action number is how we help delay the development of insecticide resistance. So we covered a lot of ground. We talked about insecticide mode of action. We talked about the insecticide resistance and how that develops in populations. And we talked about some of the things that you can do to help delay or prevent insecticide resistance through a process of resistance management. I hope this is helpful. Until we see you next time, be careful. Take care.